I know you guys are feeling the build, and right now we are going to build upon something you heard about yesterday, and that is that groundbreaking research into Parkinson's and other brain diseases that may be caused by vascular issues that researchers may not have previously known about. You heard the head of the company talk about it yesterday, and now you're going to hear the medical side, which is it's fascinating. This will be a really important takeaway, especially for any of you who know someone who has been afflicted with Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, vascular dementia. The commonalities here will surprise you. And get ready for Dr. Jack Jacobs. He received his PhD in molecular biology from Washington University, the School of Medicine, and beautiful St. Louis, Missouri. So let's hear about the first in-human research trials with a novel therapy for Parkinson's disease and other brain disorders from Dr. Jack Jacobs. Yes.
Thank you, Kennedy, for that nice introduction. First, our company's name is Zhittya, Zhittya Genesis Medicine. So you might ask, what does Zhittya mean? It's Ukrainian for life. And our vice president, one of our vice presidents is from the Ukraine. Her mom is from the Ukraine. She has relatives in the Ukraine. And as a company, we strongly believe, as I hope all of you do, for freedom, freedom for Ukraine. Thank you. Second, we're a Las Vegas biotech company. We're right here in Las Vegas. We transplanted from California. We're happy and proud to be part of Nevada. And third, I'm a scientist, so I might be a little nerdier than the previous speakers, but I hope I can share with you my enthusiasm and hope for this medicine we're developing for some pretty nasty diseases. Okay, so the drug we're developing is one you and I use all the time. It's in our bodies. It's a natural product like insulin or growth hormone. The skateboarder is going to use our drug to heal that wound on his elbow. And what our drug does simply, it stimulates the growth of new blood vessels, and that's a process known as angiogenesis. So let's take a closer look at his wound. Okay, so this is a wound, that white dotted area, let's call that the scab on his elbow. If you look underneath there, it might be hard to see, but you can see tiny little tendrils of new blood vessels. These are blood vessels that have been formed, stimulated by our drug, and they're bringing nourishment into that wounded area, bringing in oxygen, glucose, taking away waste products, and that's going to regenerate skin as an organ, so everything you need in skin, sweat glands, hair follicles, nerves. And we can use the same drug in different areas of the body that have been damaged by a lack of blood flow. There are actually over 75 human diseases that are caused by a lack of blood flow. We can think of heart attacks, lack of blood flow to the heart, stroke, lack of blood flow to areas of the brain. And so we can recreate this angiogenesis, this growth of new blood vessels, with our medicine by directly injecting it or infusing it into these damaged areas. Okay, let me talk first. This is a clinical trial that we did in the US that I supervised. These are patients, they're called no option heart patients. They can't have a bypass. They can't have a stent put in. Really, our drug was their only treatment. So we got into phase two studies in the US, and let me just show you a very short video clip. ABC News actually came to our University of Cincinnati site, interviewed our cardiologist and some of the patients there. But you can actually see blood vessels growing in the hearts of one of the patients they interviewed.
But since receiving an experimental treatment for his blocked arteries, his pain is gone.
I really feel great.
Duke was one of the first heart patients in the country to be treated with a protein actually capable
That's
of
our drug,
growing
FGF1.
Brand new arteries. The genetically engineered protein is injected directly into the heart. Within days, a network of new vessels begins to grow around the blockage, increasing the blood supply. Dr. Lynn Wagner showed us the changes in one patient's heart.
We see a small, narrow main artery and not very many secondary and tertiary arteries. This is after the treatment. What we're now seeing is new blood vessels growing here off the end of this artery.
And the patients themselves?
Symptomatically, they're improved within a couple of weeks of the treatment.
Just ask Constance Donnelly.
Oh, I feel wonderful. I've never felt so good in the last 5 years.
So that woman, Constance, was a cardiac cripple. When she came into the trial, she was in a wheelchair, and this is her 12 weeks after we treated her with the FGF1 directly into her heart. So we'll be continuing these. We still need to do another phase of testing before we can get approval for this product. I want to move now up into the brain and talk about two disorders we're treating. We have animal data for both of these, and then we've just finished our first human study in patients with Parkinson's disease. And I'll show you some videos of some of the patients, and hopefully you'll agree with me that they are showing improvement. Okay, you can give a mouse, a lab mouse, a stroke by tying off an artery in the mouse's brain. And this actually shows, these are brain slices of a lab mouse. So I always say, if you believe in reincarnation, don't come back as a lab mouse. It's not a good life. But on the left there, you can see the white area is the area of the brain that has been given a stroke. So that's basically dead brain tissue. And those on the left have not been treated with any drug. On the right, those mice have been treated, again, with our drug, FGF1 intravenously. I think you can see healing, a healing area, less infarcted tissue. If you look actually in their brains, you can see blood vessels growing back. So on the top there, that is the normal vasculature, normal capillaries inside a mouse's brain. You don't see the millions of neurons that are around those capillaries. But if you give that animal stroke, if you go to the middle panel, you can see the decimation of the vasculature, of the blood vessels in the mouse's brain. And then in that middle panel to the right are the mice that have been treated with our drug. You can see regrowth of those vessels, where you don't see that in the bottom panel, the placebo-treated animals. Are these mice getting better? They're growing new blood vessels, but are they functioning better? And again, you can put them on a rotating bar. This is a very standard test. And normal mice on the left there grab onto that rotating bar fine. In the middle are those mice that had a stroke, and we treated them with our drug. And then on the right are the placebo-treated animals. You see they cannot grab onto that rotating bar. So we're now planning studies in stroke recovery. These are patients who have had a stroke, stabilized, but have a permanent disability. And we'll be treating them in the beginning of 2023. All right, I'd like then talking about how we're using our drug to treat Parkinson's disease. So Parkinson's disease affects that dark area on the left. That's where all the neurons that are affected in Parkinson's disease reside. It's called the substantia nigra. Nigra is dark. They're pigmented. They're dark neurons. They're called dopamine neurons. These are the neurons that become dysfunctional in Parkinson's and lead to the movement disorders that are seen in that disease. This is not our work, but if you look at blood flow in that very tiny area of the brain that has the dopamine neurons, you can see in blue there, that's a healthy 21-year-old, has plenty of blood perfusion in that area where the dopamine neurons reside. And in orange there in the middle, you can see blood perfusion in a subject with Parkinson's disease, about a 50% reduction in blood flow, which we and others believe leads to the choking off of those neurons. And this initiates Parkinson's disease and leads to its progression. This is a woman who had Parkinson's, but also dementia. And this is a scan through the whole top part of her brain, which is involved, this is called the cortex, involved in memory, executive functioning. Blue is normal blood flow. Yellow is reduced, and red is severely reduced blood flow. So in this woman with dementia, if we treated her with our drug, we would hope to boost the blood supply in those regions involved in memory, executive functioning, and we will be doing clinical trials in patients with dementia. Okay, before we could go into humans, this is kind of mandated by the regulatory agencies. You've got to test your drug in animals. The gold standard for Parkinson's is a monkey model. You can give this little guy, unfortunately, a neurotoxin into his brain, and after about 6 or 7 months, the monkey comes down with all the classical symptoms of Parkinson's disease. So we tested our FGF1 drug in this model. I'll just show you a graph there. This is on the left. Four is normal movement for the monkey, and one is highly abnormal movement. So we give two groups of monkeys this neurotoxin. You can see at month 9 there, both groups of monkeys have come down with really the classical motor symptoms of Parkinson's. They have tremors. They can't walk properly. The group in blue is given our drug, FGF1, over a period of months, and you can see an improvement, reversal of their motor skill decline, where the group in red is still declining. And at the end of the study, there's a really significant difference between the motor skills between the treated group and the untreated group. We can look in the brains of these animals and say, are we attacking the root cause of Parkinson's disease? Are we regenerating new dopamine neurons? And indeed, we are. These new dopamine neurons stain brown. So on the bottom, you can see brown. There are newly regenerated dopamine neurons in the brains of these animals that had Parkinson's, and we believe this is leading to their motor skill recovery. Monkeys and humans also develop plaques in their brains, like in Alzheimer's disease. Patients with Parkinson's also develop plaques. And again, you can see that in the middle there. That's a tangled, toxic plaque, which also is detrimental to the dopamine neurons. We see on the right there in the treated animals, we're flushing out that toxic tangle of proteins. We believe this also helps in the recovery of the monkeys. Okay, so all the previous studies, we used intravenous injection, but we teamed up with a group in Minnesota that said, hey, there's a much better way to get drugs like yours into the brain. And that's just basically squirt it up the nose, make it a mist, a small aerosolized, atomized mist, and it gets up into the upper cavities of the nasal, of the nose, and through those two nerves there, the olfactory nerve and the trigeminal, we can distribute our drug throughout the brain. And amazingly, this really surprised us, twice the amount got into the brain up the nose versus putting it intravenously. So this is the way we dosed the patients that we treated. This was a study that just completed last month in the British Virgin Islands. It's 5 weeks, so 5 weeks of treatment for the patients. The drug was safe and well tolerated, and I'm going to show you some videos now of two of the patients who volunteered to be videoed on their motor skill improvement. So there's a standardized test you can give these patients to see if their motor skills have improved. This is our first subject. She had hand tremors, you can see before May 3rd there on the left, and then after her treatment on May 30th. We think she's showing significant improvement. This is another test they do in Parkinson's disease where you kind of cross your arms and stand up from a chair. So here she is on the right after treatment and on the left before treatment. She's obviously struggling. She was a great participant, and she's going to try again. You have to do this 3 times in the test, and she's popping up there like a jack-in-the-box, but really struggling before her treatment. This was actually an anesthesiologist who was in the trial who worked at a famous clinic in the Cleveland area and actually had to stop because he couldn't focus when he was in the operating room. And he's going to do some finger tapping. He had more focus problems, more cognitive issues. and he had, you can see on the, yeah, his right hand was a little bit more affected. You can see, we think, an improvement after treatment. And here he is going to be getting up from his chair, standing up. He's home now in Cleveland, and he called us and said he's reading books for the first time in 2.5 years. So to us, that shows that his focus is coming back. And this just shows some scores. I'll skip over that. There was improvement in different aspects of the questionnaire. So what I want to say, this study's over. These patients have gone home, the 8 patients. We're not stopping. We're continuing. We have 10 more patients that are coming to the British Virgin Islands in August. We have to do more in September and October. And we're also starting other studies, as shown here, other brain disorders. And I won't go through them, but some of these are pretty nasty. ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, aphasia. Bruce Willis was affected by that, where you form words in your brain, but you can't speak them, so it's a communication issue. Multiple sclerosis. So we'll be starting, again, focused research studies using the intranasal delivery to get the drug into the brain. We're right across the way there. If you want to visit us, we can give you some more information. If you want to hear more from me, you can come. I have a talk later on today at 2:10. And go to our website. We have videos there on the other medical indications as well as papers. So thank you for your attention.